solution for the tenants of Lawrence Street, because this is real people and families we're talking about, and we're well aware of that.
Thank you. We move to First Minister's questions. Question number one, Kezia Dugdale.
To ask the First Minister what engagement she has planned for the rest of the day.
First Minister.
Engagements to take forward the Government's programme for Scotland.
Kezia Dugdale.
President Officer, today marks 1 year since the First Minister took office. But she has also been... But she has also been a senior government minister for more than 8 years, including 5 in charge of the NHS. The First Minister wants us to judge the SNP government on its record, and today of all days, we should do exactly that. Now, everybody in this chamber knows somebody who has been affected by cancer. It's a horrible disease, and perhaps the most common perception is that money is no defence against it. But new statistics published this week show that that isn't the case. Can the First Minister tell me whether someone living in Scotland is more likely to get cancer if they are richer or poorer?
First Minister.
It has been a long-standing situation that people in our most deprived communities are more likely to die younger from illnesses like cancer, from stroke, from heart disease. That didn't start when the SNP came to government, presiding officer. That's been something that has been true for generations. What is equally true is that this government has been working hard, as I think it's fair to say previous governments did, to close that gap, to see rates of cancer decrease, to see survival rates from cancer increase. That's why we have policies not just about getting people access to the best cancer treatment. One of the things we've done in the last year since I've been First Minister is double the fund for new cancer medicines, a step in the right direction. But it's also why we've put such a great priority on innovative, ambitious public health measures to improve people's diets, to cut the incidence of alcohol misuse, to reduce smoking. These are the kind of policies that, frankly, it shouldn't involve party politics. Every single member of this chamber should get behind these things so that we see far, far fewer people in our country, in all parts of our country, die from cancer.
Kezia Dugdale.
Nicola Sturgeon has been responsible for our NHS in one way or another for 6 out of the last 8 years. And the reality is that in Scotland today, the likelihood of someone getting cancer too often depends on how much money they have. These new statistics show that people living in the poorest areas are 32% more likely to have cancer than those from the wealthier areas, and they are 68% more likely to die from it. That's just not right. This is 21st century Scotland, not the Victorian times. Now, I have never doubted the First Minister's sincerity, but this job needs a bit more than that. The government's cancer strategy was due to be published at the start of this year, but it has been repeatedly delayed. Can the First Minister confirm when her government's cancer strategy will be published?
First Minister.
The cancer strategy will be published in the spring of next year. We're working with stakeholders across the NHS, including some of the best cancer clinicians in the world that we are lucky to have here in Scotland, to make sure we get that strategy right, such as the importance of this particular issue. Now, Kezia Dugdale said that the fact that people in our poorest communities are more likely to die from cancer is not right. I absolutely agree with that. It wasn't right when Labour were in office. It wasn't, and it isn't right now. That is why we are working so hard to reduce deaths from cancer. And we saw figures published this week which show that overall cancer death rates have dropped by 11% in the past 10 years. Overall cancer mortality in 2014 is the lowest, and rates for cancer from breast, lung, stomach and colorectal cancer are dropping as well. So these, I think, are things that all of us should take great optimism from. But the job is not done. That is why we're working to lower cancer waiting times. Interestingly, it was Labour that set some of the current cancer waiting times. They never once were met when Labour were in government. So we're working to reduce cancer waiting times. We're working to make sure we get more people into screening programmes. That's why we're investing £30 million in Detect Cancer Early programmes, so that people come forward earlier when they've got symptoms and get diagnosed earlier, because the earlier people get diagnosed, of course, the more chance they they have of surviving. So I would say to Kezia Dugdale, in all seriousness, this is far too important for party political arguments. Let all of us unite to say we want to see an end to the situation where people in our most deprived communities are more likely to die of cancer. I think that's something worth uniting around, Presiding Officer.
There's no doubt, Presiding Officer, that we welcome that progress. But the reality is that that progress is largely happening in the richer parts of Scotland. Yeah, and that is why we need a cancer strategy. The English NHS has a widely recognised and welcome plan to fight the disease. We need the same here. In Scotland, we have a system which is failing those most in need. 66% of eligible people in the wealthiest areas are taking up bowel cancer screening. Yet the figure was just 45% for people in the poorest areas. And the most recent figures show a decline in the number of women in poorer communities getting screened for breast cancer. That lower rate of screening is one key reason why people from the poorest backgrounds are more likely to die from cancer. So does the First Minister agree with me that without dramatic government action, we could be in danger of seeing cancer as a deprivation disease in Scotland?
First Minister.
I do agree that serious government action is needed to improve early diagnosis of cancer. That's important for anybody who has cancer, but obviously with the statistics Kezia Dugdale has quoted, it is even more important that we get people from our most deprived communities into a diagnosis as quickly as possible. That's why this government is investing £39 million in our Detect Cancer Early programme. That programme has already resulted in a 4.7% increase in early stage diagnosis of cancer, alongside a 50% increase in women consulting their GP with breast symptoms and increased uptake of the National Bowel Screening Programme. That's the kind of serious, concerted action we need to see from government. Now, you know, I've said over the year I've been First Minister, I've said on many different occasions at First Minister that if anybody in this chamber has suggestions to make about things they think this government should be doing to further improve, then I am happy to listen. But in all of what I've just heard from Kezia Dugdale, I've heard not one specific suggestion of what it is she thinks this government
Mr.
should be
Simpson.
Doing. We'll continue to do the work to get people diagnosed early, to encourage people to come forward, to make sure we're giving people access to the best technologies and the best drugs, to make sure we're lowering cancer waiting times, and to make sure we're doing all of the things that we need to do to improve the public health of people in Scotland in every single part of our country.
Officer, with respect, Dr. Richard Simpson has come into this chamber for years and pushed this government to be more ambitious when it comes to cancer strategy. Because we need an NHS that's fit for the future. That means an NHS ready to tackle the challenges of the 2040s, not the 1940s. We need that bold action, but it's just not happening. Let's look at the First Minister's record. 16 years as an MSP. 8 years as a minister, 7 years as Deputy First Minister, 5 years in charge of our NHS, and this morning she had the cheek to say that she's only just getting started. Week after week, no matter what the issue, no matter the failings of her government, the First Minister always goes to tell me about her opinion poll ratings. Clearly she thinks that that answers the question. I actually think it poses a question. With her opinion poll ratings, with her majority, with all her power, what exactly is she waiting for?
First Minister.
Well, I'm not sure opinion polls are the strongest suit for a party that is now in a scrap for second place in Scotland with the Conservative Party. But since Kezia Dugdale has raised the question of opinion polls show that people trust the SNP more with the National Health Service than they trust the Labour Party or any other party in Scotland with the National Health Service. So we'll continue, Presiding Officer, to get on with the job. We've seen cancer death rates fall by 11%. We've seen, as I've just said, an increase in early stage diagnosis of cancer. We're seeing an increase in the number of people coming forward for diagnosis by their GP and coming forward for screening. We're working hard to make sure that we've got the best cancer centres. We've got 5 state-of-the-art cancer centres in Scotland. We're investing in state-of-the-art radiotherapy equipment in every single one of them. So we'll continue, Presiding Officer, with the consent of the Scottish people, to get on with the job, and we'll leave Labour, as they have been doing for so many years now, carping on the sidelines and slowly but surely getting beaten in Scotland, not by the SNP, but by the Tories.
Question number 2, Ruth Davidson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to thank the First Minister for her electoral endorsement there and ask her when she'll next meet the Secretary of State for Scotland.
No plans in the near future, but I've got a thank you to Ruth Davidson as well. I'd like to thank her for making sure I got a copy this morning of the internal Tory lines to take for the day. They've got nothing to say about David Cameron's new taxpayer-funded private jet, but nevertheless, they were very helpful. I'll take it as a wee anniversary present.
Okay. Thank you.
Ruth Davidson.
Presiding Officer, on Tuesday, a parents' group called Fair Funding for Our Kids met the Education Secretary to ask for some basic details on how the SNP government plans to meet its pledge to double nursery entitlement. They left that meeting so frustrated that they decided to speak out, as Angela Constance was unable to provide even ballpark figures on how that pledge could possibly be met. They wanted to know that if this government is to double childcare by 2020, how many extra places that will take, how many extra staff need to be hired, how many apprenticeships to train new staff, how many more nurseries need to be built, how much money will this cost, and where is it going to come from? They say Angela Constance could not answer a single one of these questions. Can the First Minister?
First Minister.
Yeah, it will cost £880 million. Where that will come from will be set out in our budgets. It will take 20,000 additional staff. That will be a mixture of college places and apprenticeships. We're currently working with local authorities to determine the expansion of capacity that will be required. That will be a mixture of new build and extension of current local authority capacity. I noted with interest the press release that Fair Funding for Our Kids put out yesterday, a group of parents that I think are to be commended for their determination around this issue, but they say there aren't enough places now to deliver our policy of doubling childcare. And that, I have to say, is the case. That's why it's a commitment that we've made to double childcare over the next 5 years and invest more than £800 million in delivering that. I think that is a commitment parents in Scotland will want to get behind. So we know where the SNP stand. We're going to double free childcare over the next Parliament. The question is, what's the Tory policy?
Ruth Davidson.
More flexibility, and we'd love you to take it up now. But I'd like to thank the First Minister.
Order! Order! Order, Miss Davidson.
For giving everyone the answers that her Education Secretary seemed unable to find yesterday. And there's a reason that the mums were asking her these questions. And it was this. It's because they've gone to potentially the biggest of the childcare providers, Glasgow City Council, and they've been told that the Scottish Government's plans are, and I quote, impossible. And the First Minister knows this because the mums wrote to her on the 23rd of September telling her it. I have the letter here. We spoke to this parents group yesterday. They believed the government a year ago when it said it wanted to help, but they now feel utterly disillusioned and have lost all trust. For the last year, the First Minister has enjoyed the headlines, but eventually she's going to have to start delivering. These parents no longer believe that she will. So what is the First Minister going to physically do to restore that trust?
Well, First what Minister, I'm going to physically do is invest £800 million to build the capacity in our system to double the provision of free childcare. Ruth Davidson is going to give more flexibility. Well, she might have heard me a few weeks ago say that flexibility will be built in to our policy so that parents can take their eligible hours, not just during term time, but during school holidays as well. There can be more flexible ability to fit that in with the working patterns that parents have. That's the ambitious ambitious plans that this government has. And let me tell Ruth Davidson what the chief executive, no, she might want to listen to this, the chief executive of Early Years Scotland has to say about it this very day. They welcome the Scottish government's commitment. Yes, they say there are challenges, but they say that they know that with, they are sure that with our exceptionally dedicated workforce and downright determination to give every child the best start in life, then we will work together to ensure that this laudable ambition becomes an everyday reality. Double childcare provision, that's the everyday reality that this government is going to deliver.
Question three, Willie Rennie.
To ask the First Minister what issues will be discussed at the next meeting of the Cabinet.
First Minister.
Matters of importance to the people of Scotland.
Willie Rennie.
The timetable for the Government's national testing for schools has slipped. The Government now expects MSPs to scrap the existing system before details for the new tests are even published. We've seen a cost estimate of £12.5 million. That could be used for 400 teachers instead. And the First Minister told us she was against crude league tables. But the EIS warned this week that if she carries on, league tables will be back. For a flagship policy, all that's a shambles, isn't it?
First Minister.
No, it's not. I think there is a disagreement between myself and Willie Rennie, and you know, there's disagreements between myself and Willie Rennie on many things. But I want to make sure that we're raising standards in our schools. I want to make sure that we continue to close the attainment gap in our schools between children in our least deprived areas and those in our most deprived areas. And I want to make sure that parents have the information that they want about their children's progress. And I want to make sure that I've got the information I need as First Minister to assure the country that we're making progress on these aims. I'm not interested in the return of league tables. I'm not interested in high-stakes testing that has teachers teaching to the test. But I don't think it is acceptable that we can't have that information in primary schools and in early secondary schools to know whether the action we are taking, such as the £100 million attainment challenge, are working to deliver the objectives that we've set. So Willie Rennie and I will continue, no doubt, to debate this, but I'm on the side of making sure not only that we're driving up standards in our schools and closing the attainment gap, but that we're able to evidence the fact that we're doing so, and I make no apology for that.
Willie Rennie.
She repeatedly says she's not interested in crude league tables, but she's not going to do a single thing to stop them happening. Information requests gathered by Common Space have shown that the Scottish Government only had 4 emails with advice on national testing from only 2 people, and they each had reservations. That's why I think it's quite right to say this is a shambles. Poorly informed, badly led, set to divert money from teaching, bringing back crude league tables. There's growing opposition from parents, teachers and unions. She says she's consulting. She says she is consulting. But are there any circumstances which the First Minister would abandon these plans?
First Minister.
No, I'm not going to abandon these plans because I think these plans are right. I want to see us raise standards, close the attainment gap and have the ability to evidence that we're doing that. Yes, we're talking to teachers and to parents as we develop the National Improvement Framework. And Willie Rennie, if he's taken the time to read it, will know that the proposal for assessments, which are already carried out in 30 out of 32 local authorities, are part of that National Improvement Framework. We're talking to teachers and others about the timing of the assessments to avoid the high-stakes teach-to-the-test approach that many people, including me, are against. We're talking carefully about how we use the information so that we can avoid league tables that nobody wants to see a return to. But I will not apologise for wanting to make sure that I'm able to stand up in this chamber and tell other members and tell the country at large what is happening in our schools and for giving parents access to the information about the progress of their children in schools. These are assessments not to replace teacher judgment, which is at the core of curriculum for excellence. These are assessments about informing teacher judgment. It's the right thing to do. We'll continue to talk to others about it, but we'll get on with the job of making sure we are raising standards in our school, which is what people across the country expect us to do.
Question number four, Jim Eadie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what steps the Scottish Government is taking to promote early HIV testing.
First Minister.
It's vitally important that those who are at risk of having contracted HIV are tested promptly. That's why we have reiterated our commitment to promote early HIV testing in the revised framework that was published in September. The government is providing more than £28 million this year to support NHS boards and third sector organisations to deliver this framework across Scotland. And importantly, Presiding Officer, this includes funding to tackle the stigma associated with HIV infection, because that stigma is still one of the greatest barriers to people getting tested early.
Jimmy Dave.
I thank the First Minister for that answer. She will be aware that Waverley Care, HIV Scotland and the Terence Higgins Trust have stated that the barriers to HIV testing do indeed include stigma, fear and lack of awareness. Looking ahead to European HIV Hepatitis Testing Week, does the First Minister agree with me that having postal testing initiatives like the Fast Test Service from the Terence Higgins Trust can help to overcome those barriers, raise awareness of early HIV testing, ensure those who have tested positive receive the treatment they need as soon as possible, and ultimately help prevent needless deaths?
First Minister.
Yes, I do agree with that, and I would hope people across the chamber will agree with that. HIV postal tests are available to any adult living in Scotland through the Terence Higgins Trust website. Confidential testing is also provided by Waverley Care in some parts of the country, and we've changed the law so that the sale of instant result self-testing kits is now legal. These arrangements, of course, complement NHS provision, but they can be particularly helpful for individuals who are nervous about approaching their GP or sexual health clinic for a test. So it's absolutely vital, and Jimmy Dee is right to raise this as an issue, that we do everything we can to deal with and allay the stigma associated with HIV so that people are encouraged to come forward for prompt testing.
Question number five, Jackie Baillie.
To ask the First Minister what discussions the Scottish Government has had with the UK Government regarding using the new welfare top-up powers that are being devolved.
First Minister.
Scottish Governments continue to have regular discussions with the UK Government about the devolution of social security. These discussions happen through the Joint Ministerial Working Group on Welfare and also as a key element of discussions at the Joint Exchequer Committee. There are also regular discussions between officials. Deputy First Minister has also written to the UK Government to ask for confirmation that any additional or increased benefits provided by the Scottish Government will not result in the UK Government simply reducing reserve benefits and effectively clawing back the funds provided.
Jackie Baillie.
Thank you. I hope the First Minister will eventually agree with Labour on restoring cuts to tax credits and that she will raise this in face-to-face meetings. In the meantime, there are other new powers coming to the Scottish Parliament. The cold weather payment worth £25 a week and, of course, winter fuel payments worth £100 to £300 for pensioner households, together with decisions about the implementation of the energy company obligation. I hope she agrees with me that with fuel poverty at a staggering 940,000 households affecting some 2 million people in Scotland, that this is a national scandal. Can I ask the First Minister, with all due respect, when will she get on with her job? Fuel poverty increased on her watch, and will the First Minister admit that she will not meet the pledge of ending fuel poverty by November 2016 and tell us what she will do with these new powers to help families and pensioners having to choose between heating and eating this winter?
First Minister.
Well, I'll... And we will bring forward plans to use all of our new powers in the interests of people in Scotland. Some of the powers that Jackie Baillie has listed there, for example, over the winter fuel payments, do give us the opportunity to look at overall what we do to try to tackle fuel poverty. But, you know, Jackie Baillie is standing there as the representative of the party that 2 weeks ago, when they had the opportunity not just to vote for sticking plaster powers, but to vote for the devolution of tax credits and the devolution of the budget with tax credits. Yes. Did they vote with the SNP for that? No. They trooped through the lobbies of the House of Commons with the Tories to keep these powers in the hands of Conservatives. That's the action of Labour politicians that people in Scotland are judging day in and day out. And let's also not forget that while others, to their credit, on her benches were voting for £167 billion to be spent on things that matter, not on nuclear weapons, Jackie Baillie was voting with the Tories to renew the Trident nuclear weapons programme. So Jackie Baillie's Jackie Baillie's credibility on these issues before today, I thought, presiding officer, was pretty ropey. But I think yesterday she probably ended any credibility she had absolutely, completely, when she went to the Finance Committee and said, and I quote, my maths are shaky. I think that sums it up, presiding officer.
Linda Fabiani.
Thank you, presiding officer. Can I draw the First Minister's attention to comments made by the STUC General Secretary yesterday when he recognised the importance of the financial framework for any additional powers. And to quote him, he said, it would be completely wrong for the Deputy First Minister to sign up to a mechanism for block grant adjustment which would structurally disadvantage Scotland. Does the First Minister agree with me that Jackie Baillie and her group should heed the advice of the STUC, stop mouthing some of the UK Tory party's words and stand up for Scotland?
First Minister.
Well, I think Jackie Baillie and Labour stopped listening to the STUC the day they decided to go into an alliance with the Tory party in Scotland in the referendum. But yes, I did see the comments of the STUC yesterday. Indeed, I saw the comments today of Professor Anton Muscatelli, the principal of Glasgow University, who's also warning about the dangers of an unfair fiscal framework. These are credible, independent voices that should be listened to, not just by Labour, but right across this chamber. Indeed, Professor Muscatelli was a member of the Kalman Commission. Now, for our part, we've made clear we will only support a legislative consent motion on the Scotland Bill if there is a satisfactory and fair fiscal framework agreed between the Scottish and UK governments. Nobody, absolutely nobody, not even Labour, could reasonably expect any government to say anything else.
Patrick Harvey.
Thank you. If the new welfare powers are to be used successfully to tackle fuel poverty, as Jackie Baillie was asking for, they're going to have to work in concert with the money government is spending on energy efficiency in the home. And yet, committee witnesses working in this sector don't appear to have had any opportunity to discuss ahead of the budget or ahead of the National Infrastructure Project with government how that's going to work. Why haven't they, and when will we hear any of the details involved?
First Minister.
Well, we'll discuss these things as these powers are implemented. Now, I know Patrick Harvey is a supporter of this and we agree on many of these issues, but you know, even Patrick Harvey must concede these new powers over winter fuel payments, for example, are not going to be in place in the next financial year. We will work with stakeholders as we take over these powers to look at how we use them effectively. But Patrick Harvey is absolutely right to say that it is vital, as all of these powers come to Scotland, that we integrate them effectively with powers and resources that we already have. And I look forward to Patrick Harvey being a key member of that discussion as we take forward these plans in the months and years to come.
Question six, Liz Smith.
To ask the First Minister what discussions the Scottish Government has had with NHS 24 regarding the provision of winter resilience measures.
First Minister.
NHS 24 published their winter plans last month. These build on the excellent service provided to patients last winter when over 75,000 calls were received during the festive period and more than 9 in 10 of these calls were answered within 30 seconds. To ensure the integrity of their winter plan, NHS 24 took the decision last week to pause the introduction of their new patient contact system. A full review is underway into the issues with the new system. I expect an initial report in December and a full detailed report in January.
Liz Smith.
Could I thank the First Minister for that? Obviously, last month, in its update on the management of the IT contract for NHS 24, Audit Scotland said that the total cost of the future programme had risen by 55% on the original cost predicted over 2 years ago, and that increase was mainly due to the costs of delayed implementation. And as the First Minister has just said, there is a further delay to the new IT system that was announced last Friday. Can the First Minister tell this Parliament what will now be the cost to the taxpayer of this mismanaged project, and can she give a categorical assurance that patient care will not be put in jeopardy this winter?
First Minister.
Well, can I say to Liz Smith, because she raises very important issues, and I think it's right that they are raised in this Parliament. I think it was disappointing, very disappointing, that this decision had to be taken last week, but it was taken in the interest of patient safety, which is the issue Liz Smith is raising. So clearly it was the right one to take in line with that. The new system hasn't been abandoned. I think it's important to stress that. The implementation has been paused to allow issues to be resolved. The full review that I referred to in my earlier answer is underway, which will in itself answer many of the questions that Liz Smith has raised today. We will get the initial report of that review in December and the full report in January. In addition to that, the Health Secretary has asked the Chief Nursing Officer to provide reassurance about the plans for reintroduction. I think it's important to say in terms of cost and the issues with the cost being higher than originally projected have already been discussed in detail in the public domain. But over time, NHS 24 still considers that the new system will allow them to save costs every year. And I think it's important to bear that in mind. But I'll be very happy, and indeed it is incumbent on us, to make sure that as this review takes place and as we get the findings of that, those findings are shared in full with Parliament.
Richard Simpson.
Can I thank the First Minister for her detailed reply on this issue? I'm slightly surprised that a large project of this sort was not, the problems were not solved at the beta testing level, but I welcome the fact that in the interest of patient safety it's been suspended. However, we've now had two reports from Audit Scotland, 2012 and 2015, highly critical of the government's management of large ICT projects. The new structure set up by the government, I would ask the First Minister to look at very carefully, because they are the most shambolic and system that I have ever seen. No business would run its IT systems on the system the government has set up in response to the Audit Scotland report. I ask her now to undertake to relook at that structure.
First Minister.
Well, I think Richard Simpson will have heard me say that a full review is underway. I mean, these are serious issues, Presiding Officer. Detailed plans were in place to manage the transition to the new system, including the contingency of reverting to the legacy system if that was required. Some issues impacting in performance were initially, some of the issues impacting on performance were out with the control of NHS 24, including issues with the wider telecommunications network. NHS 24 have apologised to patients who were affected by delays, and it is a priority to make sure that this new system is in place and working as quickly as possible. But that must be done in a way that is consistent with patient safety, particularly given that we're going into the winter and the festive period. So NHS 24 have taken the right decision here in the circumstances. But all of the issues that have been raised, both by Liz Smith and by Richard Simpson, will be looked at in terms of this review and the findings, of course, as I've already said, shared with Parliament.
Thank you. That ends First Minister's questions. We are now going to move to members' business. So members who leave the chamber should do so quickly and quietly.